Welcome back. You're still watching Countdown, and the markets are now trading again at day's high at fresh record high levels, and the broader markets have started to move on now. The Nifty Midcap Index is now trading with 0.8% of a gain, and the small cap too has seen good gains. We'll take you through the gainers in the broader markets, but before that, Yash Upadhyay joins us with the Fab Four stocks of the day. Yash, over to you.
Thanks for that, Navneet. So we kick things off with Apollo Microsystems, and the stock is the first, it's the first IPO of 2018, and what a bumper start it has had, giving listing day gains of over 70%. The stock opened at a price of about 478 versus its issue price of 275. We've seen huge demand for the 156 crore IPO, which got subscribed over 248 times. So good news for Apollo Microsystems. Good numbers coming in from GNFC as well, and the stock is up about 4%. EBITDA saw a significant increase, coming more than doubling to 427 crore rupees. Net profit too, seeing a threefold growth. EBITDA margins saw a huge bump up, almost 10 percentage points, coming in at 27%. So good numbers from GNFC as well. Jaykumar Infra Projects is another stock that we're looking at, and it has snapped its two-day losing streak after the company said that it has received an order worth close to 60 crore rupees for the construction of 8 metro rail projects from the Delhi Metro Rail Corporation of India. And finally, good moves coming in from Precall India as well. The stock has surged as much as 8.5% today after the company said that it has entered into an exclusive partnership with China's Donghua Shenpen Electronics to introduce electric water pumps in the Indian market. Back to you.
All right, Yash, thanks a lot for bringing all those details. Well, let's tell you some gainers from the broader markets. Omax Auto has been locked in upper circuit since the morning. Reason being, the numbers were pretty good. They came out on Saturday. The company posted a profit figure versus the loss, which was seen in the corresponding quarter. Pull up Sobha. That's gone up almost between 11 to 12%. The other stocks which are going up are the likes of Shimaru. Kamath Hotel is up almost 11%, and you've got Action Construction. That stock is back into action. It's up almost 9 or 10%, and it is locked in upper circuit with gains of nearly 10%. I mean, anything from the stocks I highlighted look good on the charts? Sobha, Action Construction, Shimaru?
Sobha, Action Construction, Shimaru. Short-term point of view, I think it's Action which looks interesting. I think we are on the verge of taking out 172, which was the intermediate and long-term high. Sobha, nice support at 530. It's probably ended a correction and could be taking out 640. Then that would mean a resumption of its longer-term uptrend.
Okay, so that's the call coming in on Sobha. Another interesting stock in today's trade, if you look at it, would be Biocon, which is up 6.5%. There was, of course, update over last week, and it moved up, I think, on Friday as well. If you could just pull up last 2 days' chart. Today's move has been mostly over last 1 hour or so when the stock has gained with good volumes. And this is the return over last 7 days, almost 11% so far. So two straight days of gains for the stock. Hemen, have you looked at this chart, Biocon at 605? What would be your call?
We are in a multi-year uptrend. 10 years to be precise, Pradeep, and still continues. Clear blue sky, all-time high levels. I think as long as we remain above 570, 75, I don't know if it's a fresh long, but if it's a position hold.
By the way, just before we get in, Dharmesh Khan, the V-Guard number is out on your screen as well, and the bottom line performance is very, very strong, which is what is maybe aiding the stock as well. I would presume should be aiding the stock. 41% jump in PAT. The stock is up about 3.5% in trade. A bit of a spike there. Dharmesh Kant, independent market expert, joins us right now on the show. As the Nifty, by the way, is 10,974. We are up 80 points. Just bring up the Nifty before we go to Dharmesh. 10,974, I think we're trading at the high point of the day. And we are about 26 points away, or 27 points away from 11,000. Don't think too many people anticipated this at the start of the calendar, that we'll do this in January. Not saying we will, maybe we won't, but it looks a very, very strong market for now. Heavyweights are participating. Dharmesh Kant, independent market expert on the show. Dharmesh, good having you. Thanks so much for joining in. What's happening with TCS, Dharmesh? I can understand Mindtree, very strong set of numbers. Stock went up, continuing its momentum. TCS is up 5.5.
Yeah, good afternoon, Viraj. See, the market has been scaling new highs, and rightly so, because the numbers which have come so far has been very robust, be it large caps, mid cap or small cap. So earlier, you know, the cry was numbers are not there, earnings are not coming, and now the earnings have been, you know, filtering in rock solid. All the large caps more or less have reported more than 20% kind of earnings growth. And mid cap, small cap, we are seeing almost doubling of the earnings growth. So that trajectory has been taken well care of. As far as TCS is concerned, the numbers were, you know, okay kind of a number. Both TCS and Infosys, the good part was that there was no unpleasant surprise. And if you look at the market, I mean, if you segregate or shred the market behavior in this month, we are almost up 4%, 4.5% now on Nifty levels for this January month. The breadth has been very narrow of the market. Though the earnings are there, but at the same time, if you look at the trajectory of the decliners are far, far more than the advances in the month of January. If you look at, you know, 200, 500, say if Nifty is up 4.5%, then the next Nifty 100 is up 3.5%, Nifty 500, I mean, BSE 500 is up only 2.5% kind of a scene. So it has been narrowing. And this is what is concerning me about the texture of the market, this uptrend which is there. Not, you know, ideally comparing this with 2007 December period, but that was a similar kind of scenario when we were scaling new heights. Numbers for Q3 were almost good. When it came in the month of January, they were in line with what the street was expecting. But at the same time, the market topped out there. So I think this fire which is there in the market should be, you know, treated with caution. IT index itself is up more than 10% in the month of January, followed by banking and financials, primarily through private sector banks, which are up more than 4.5 to 5%. So Axis Bank numbers again were rock solid. But from investment perspective, I think it's time to take note of the situation. Book your profits, at least 50% of the profit out of the table, and remain invested with, you know, balance 50% of the profit, maybe with a trailing stop loss from trading perspective. I don't expect much, you know, fireworks after the budget in this market. So caution has to be there. We will see this type of, you know, exaggerated movements like TCS one day picking up, or ITC, or I mean, Reliance, the numbers were good again, but the 5% kind of move from here on immediately is not warranted out there. So such things will be there with no justification out there on the valuation perspective. But the market will, you know, keep up throwing up such stocks on a daily basis.
Well, India VIX too, as you've been saying, just pull up India VIX before we go to Navneet for talking about the FNO space. India VIX is up 10%, 15.42 levels now. This would be probably the highest levels that we've seen since that correction, bit of a correction that had happened sometime in December, wherein we had gone up, I think, northwards of 15 on India VIX. So a bit of a jump there to maybe a month highs or thereabouts, if I'm not wrong. With the 6 month levels there, you can see, I think somewhere in middle of December, we had shot to northwards of 15, close to 16, and just scaled back quite sharply when the markets rallied, and now moving up again. The difference is this time around, we're rallying a bit. Anyways, it's 310. Let's get in a sense from Navneet as to what are the stocks that could enter the FNO ban or come out of the FNO ban as well in the expiry week. Navneet?
I've never had so many stocks in my list. There are 10 stocks which are already in ban, and there are 9 which feature in my list today. But just a caveat here, the trends do change in the last 15 to 20 minutes of trade. So these are just the stocks which are just popping up in my list. Dewan Housing is one of them. If you look at the overall open interest as a percentage of MWPL on Friday was 94.7. So just at the borderline, if you can see, 95% is the ratio which is used for a stock to enter into the FNO ban. The other one is Jayaprakash Associates, a company which has been active post its numbers, so watch out for that. Reliance Communication also, the total open interest on Friday was pretty much higher, almost 92%. Let's pull up the other plate. Jet Airways is the next one, 91.7. Reliance Capital just at. So you can see actually on Friday itself, there are almost 6 stocks where overall open interest was above 90% for a stock to enter into the FNO ban. Again, highlighting it is 95%. Let's pull up the next plate. There are 3 more stocks which could enter. IDFC Bank, this is pretty active today. Jubilant Foodworks, which is up almost 9 to 10%. There is huge amount of long buildup being seen in this counter right from Friday once it reported its earnings. And Raymond is the other one where a buildup has been seen both on the futures as well as a couple of option strikes. And there are 3 stocks which may come out of the FNO ban. One of them will be your stock. HCC is the top one, 83.7. For a stock to come out of the FNO ban, it has to breach the 80% mark. So we've seen some unwinding for a couple of option strikes here. Dish TV is the other one, and the next one is Jain Irrigation. All these 3 counters in today's session have seen unwinding for their futures as well as a couple of the option strike. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Navneet, for the update. So we'll keep an eye on all these stocks. Jay, if you have had a look at some of these names, any interesting trade that you have spotted in, say, Jet Airways, JP Associates, or Jan Irrigation, which is moving out, or ADH Group stocks, RCOM and RCAP?
Well, none of these stocks really are of that interest to me, I would say, Pradeep, honestly. But then, as you know, none of them actually really provides that kind of a trading opportunity to the traders wherein one can consecutively make profits, can consistent profits. They all are highly volatile stocks and they offer the trading opportunities. You know, it's like every fortnightly, you say, or maybe, you know, you say, like, you know, twice in a month, either of which. That's how their trade setups are generally most of the times. So as of now, if I have to actually really select any one of these, then I would say that, you know, Jan Irrigation, maybe, you know, this can be one of the stock which can inch higher from these levels. Just keeping in mind that, you know, it doesn't break its 40 DMA, that's around 125 levels on the lower side, because that's holding it quite well, I would say, since a couple of trading sessions, and till those levels are held, that is 125. This stock, you know, earlier it had in fact taken off its previous monthly swing high of 134. So if 125 continues to hold on, I think, you know, we can see this stock inching towards the levels of 180 or so positionally. So that would be my call on Jan Irrigation. I would think of all these stocks which you have just mentioned, I think this is one stock wherein the risk reward is definitely unfavorable.
Wow. Okay. Look at Just Dial. It's up 8.5 now. Reliance, of course, has been doing what it is doing. I think from those levels, the list of gainers is stable. Not too many losers at that, but for HPCL, Dish TV is down about 2.5, must mark that. And there is some weakness in Idea Cellular, which is down about 2.5% as well. So on a relatively strong day, some weakness too. Whether the markets too have just come off a little bit in the last few minutes of trade, about 13, 15 points, very, very swiftly in the last, whatever, 4 or 5 minutes of trade. What are dealing rooms saying though in the session today? Let's get in our in-house experts, Yatin and Darshan, join in with their channel checks. Good afternoon to both of you. Darshan, let's start off with you. What are you gathering from your sources?
Yeah, so one of the stocks that's doing extremely well in today's trade is BHEL. There is a domestic mutual fund which is actively accumulating the counter. Moved up on heavy volumes today also, 1.17 million shares. So there is a lot of traction that's happening in BHEL. The next one is Tata Chemicals. There's a buzz of a potential corporate announcement that could come in, and so that's something that we are looking at. And finally, the NAS stock that dealers are talking about is Genus Power. The numbers will be out over the next few days. Some of the HNIs are accumulating on the anticipation of a strong set of numbers. But Yatin, what are you hearing?
United Spirits, you know, that is one stock which has seen some good momentum, and dealers are expecting a 3 to 4% trading upside. Of course, they will be reporting their results also very, very shortly. But ahead of that, we have seen a decent run-up and a good, you know, volume momentum as far as this stock is concerned. However, Federal Bank, that is one stock wherein FIs are said to be sellers. And, you know, post their results, we have seen some pressure coming in at higher levels. So dealers are expecting some trading downside here as well. And do watch out for Dishman Carbo Generics. You know, this was the formerly known as Dishman Pharma. And post the scheme of arrangement, this is the new company which has been formed. And dealers do indicate that domestic funds are aggressive buyers in the counter trade. 6.5% up for this one on decent volumes. Dealers expecting a short-term 10 to 15% upside in this pharma name. So watch out for this one.
Okay, we'll watch out for all of these. Thanks for that, Yatin, as well as Darshan. Dishman Carbogen is doing well. What is also doing very well is Sobha, that stock, on volumes which are significantly high than the 10-day average or the 20-day averages, is up about 12%, 1.5 million shares traded out here. And it's probably a solitary move because I don't think too many other real estate names have had a really big move in the session today. Yes, they may be in the green, but a quiet green. Sobha is actually charting a bit of a lone course out here today. Any thoughts out here, Dharmesh? Sobha Limited?
Yes, a good company and has been doing particularly well in the South India. And I think the type of projects they have landed on and with attraction in the, you know, medium to low cost housing, it tends to gain from there. And there has been attraction as far as the sales are concerned, particularly in the Bangalore region. The attraction has been pretty good, and numbers expected are to be 20% plus kind of a PAT growth kind of a numbers are being expected. So I think, you know, that's the reason why you are seeing some movement out there. But my own sense is, rather than again investing in real estate stock after the, you know, big move which we have seen in Sobha, Nantaraj, Kolte Patil type, so it's better to, you know, shift to housing finance companies. And again, in this budget, there may be further impetus to the, you know, low cost and rural housing. So the housing finance companies with a, you know, pan India kind of a reach can be accumulated, because all of them have corrected quite a bit. And there the names are like Canfin Homes is there, Epco Home Finance is there, LIC Housing Finance is there. So these are pretty good, you know, solid companies doing pretty well. And valuation comfort is also there. So one should be buying into that. As far as cost of funds and other things are concerned, that would be hardening up from them. So the margins and everything will not be so rosy as it was earlier. But at the same time, business traction will take care of the valuation part. So 20-30% kind of an up move for the next fiscal year is what I'm expecting from these companies. So my advice would be, rather than buying real estate plays directly, one should be buying into housing finance companies.
Speaking of housing finance, by the way, today, Grah Finance has lost 15%, and this is the biggest fall in, I think, over 2.5 years for Sobha. So it gained an equivalent amount in Friday's session. It's Grah Finance, excuse me, and it's given up an equivalent amount in today's session, 588. Two big moves, divergent ones at that. Hemen, before we get in your closing strategies, a word on Sobha Limited, a word on Grah Finance.
Sobha, 530, very strong support, bounce back, will close above 55-day moving average, breakout above 640, long-term outlook positive, should move up further. Grow Finance, I think every day is not Sunday. I mean, you can't have this silly stock move from 500 to 710 in 1 week. Is it a pump and up? I don't know, but this is ridiculous. So it can't sustain at this momentum, no way. I think very, very well done. I think it needs to cool off.
Which is cooling off, Grow Finance. It's down almost 15% in today's session. But the other pack which is doing well are the Godrej group of companies. So Godrej Consumer, Godrej Properties, and even Godrej Industries, all three of them have seen good gains today. Godrej Consumer almost a day's high with gains of 4%. Properties too, which is one of the gainers in the Nifty Realty Index today. And Industries too, as you've seen the intraday chart, it's just gone up in the last 5 to 10 minutes of trade. Jay, I'll come to you. Any of these stocks, do they look good on the charts?
Absolutely. No, I would rank Godrej Industries in the, you know, on the first place. As far as the chart pattern is concerned, the stock is really trading in an upward sloping parallel channel. Seems to have completed its wave 4 on the lower side. The indicators on the weekly and the monthly charts are well into the buy mode. And the stock is likely to inch towards the upper end of the range. And that would come to, in fact, 829 levels. So that's for the positional traders, I would say, Navneet, 829 with a stop loss of 576. Or maybe, you know, I would say that with a low of, in fact, 532. Now, for the short-term traders, you know, we have done with the positional traders. For the short-term traders, I would say, with a stop loss of 589, one can target this stock to take off at least its previous swing high of 699. So 699 for the short-term traders, 829 for the medium-term traders. I also like Godrej Consumer Products. And I would say this stock, too, in fact, you know, it looks quite good on a daily and the weekly charts. And I think this can be bought, too. But then, you know, if I have to really just select one stock of all these three, then undoubtedly it would be Godrej Industries.
Okay. Just before we take in closing strategies, just wanted to mark some small caps which have jumped up today. Omax Auto is up 20%. Copron is up 6.5%. There is strength in Arman Financial Services, which is up another 5% today. And while Parag Milk was the dairy company which was very active, look at KSC Limited, again, a dairy-related company, and that stock is up about 5% too. Very interesting for KSC, it's at 2200, was at about 500 about a year and a half or 2 years ago. So KSC Limited too has done well. But let's get in closing strategies from our experts. Hemen, to you first, your top closing strategy.
Got toss up between a Kajaria Ceramic and Tata Communication.
You tell us.
Kajaria.
Kajaria Ceramics, what, 1% stop, 2% target?
Yes, Kajaria is currently, 719.65. Entry at 719, stop loss 714, target 729.
Okay. Jay, what about you? Your top closing strategy?
Well, top closing strategy definitely, Neeraj, would be Reliance Futures. You know, after having taken off this multiple swing resistances of around 960, 65 zone, definitely one can place a stop loss below those levels and in fact carry it as a BTST as well or a positional trade as well, which I have already given for nine with a stop loss of 944 targeting around 1004 on the upside. Along with this, I would like to add two more stocks, Neeraj. One would be buy on Sudarshan Chemicals, which I think, you know, has clearly seems to have taken off as swing resistance on the upside, as well as, you know, provided a breakout from a downward sloping channel in its wave four, targeting around 501 on the upside with a stop loss of 426. One can buy this as well. And a final buy recommendation would be on Wabag. This stock in today's trading session, in fact, has managed to move beyond its 200 DMA resistance, and now having, you know, almost closing above those levels, I think, and this also becomes a good buy for a target of 660 with a stop loss of 623.50. So these two would be the positional calls. Reliance can be a BTST as well as a positional both.
Okay, so several trading ideas actually coming here from Jay. Dharmesh, if you have had a look at Alembic Limited, this is a stock which has moved up over last few minutes, up 8.5% now. Most of it has come over last half an hour or so, maybe less. Any views here?
Sorry, Pradeep, I do not track this company closely, so won't be able to comment on that.
Okay, you can look at it 9.5% now, Alembic at 69.20. Hemen, have you looked at this chart?
4-year consolidation, breakout above 56, testing its all-time high, further upside possible.
Further upside possible, so Alembic one can hold on. Dharmesh, before we let you go, another segment which is doing well is actually chemical, including fertilizers, though I would say. And if you have looked at Make Money Organics, Uniforce Enterprises, or you know, for that matter, several other stocks in this segment that have been doing quite well, anything that you would like to pick up?
See, the entire fertilizer space, normally, you know, before the budget, they tend to move up because of, you know, some freebies coming in the budget is being expected. So that's a natural build-up in all these stocks. So that has been there. But at the same time, you know, economic growth has been there and the numbers have been picking up. The volume offtake has been good. Not to forget that this is in spite of the fact that, you know, input prices have also been going up for these fertilizer companies. So, but overall, you know, pricing power is there and they would be doing well on a business front as well. My top pick from this entire space will be from the private sector play, and that is UPL. United Phosphorus is the stock which one should be buying into. At current levels, I am expecting around 20-25% kind of an up move for, you know, medium term kind of a basis. Numbers should be, you know, very good for them. And that is what my own sense is, 25-30% kind of a PAT growth is what is being expected from UPL. So all the, I mean, from the entire lot, this looks to me the most promising.
Okay. Dharmesh, we leave it at that. Thanks so much for taking the time out and joining us and giving us your perspectives. Just want to mark the hotel companies before we hand it over to Navneet for the market wrap. And I think Indian Hotels is up about 5 or 6%. I saw Kamath Hotels up about 10%. I don't know what EIH has done, but Indian Hotels, Kamath Hotels, maybe Rugby. Actually, Rugby is a tiny tune. Let's not bring that up. Let's bring up EIH and see if that is moving around about 2.5%. So the hotel companies are having a good move in the session today. Anyway, just final thoughts, and let's wrap up this day's trade as well. Squarely belongs to Reliance, TCS, and maybe a couple of other names, because those are the ones that are dominating trade. But 33 points away from 11,000, Navneet, pretty decent close.
Definitely, Neeraj, a new week, new day, newer highs. And let me tell you, this is becoming a new normal for our markets. The template remains the same, that buy on dips. And today, if you see, the rally was broad-based. Nifty is closing with gains of 73 points. Sensex up almost 274 points. And Bank Nifty also participated. In fact, Bank Nifty will be closing above the mark of 27, which is a positive takeaway. Let's just see the broader markets. So Nifty mid-cap free float index registering gains of almost 1%. Let's not forget, the broader markets have been under pressure in the last few few days. So they've bounced back today. The Nifty small cap index up almost 68 points and the BSE mid cap index also registering strong gains in today's trade. Let's look at Sensex constituents and see which were the stocks which contributed to the gains today. Let me start off with the list of gainers. TCS, the heavyweight, up almost 5%. Reliance Industries reacting positively to its numbers. Brokerages giving a thumbs up. ONGC, after the deal announced that they will be picking up government stake in HPCL. Once again, brokerages gave a thumbs up to this one too. Axis Bank reacted positively to its numbers. Yes Bank, L&T were a couple of other stocks which did well. Let me just highlight the heavyweights. Infi is also closing the day in green alongside HDFC Bank, which was up just about 0.6%. On the losing side, your top loser on Sensex was Tata Motors DVR, and your heavyweight HDFC was down almost 2%. Wipro was the other stock which was under pressure. And remember, Asian Paints will be coming out with its earnings ahead of that. That counter is closing the day with some cuts. And State Bank of India, ICICI Bank, the other heavyweight is ITC in the pack, which have closed the day in the red.
Well, Namneet, if you look at the mid-cap space, picture remains quite positive. Alembic is one stock that I would like to highlight. The stock moved up over last 15 minutes of trade. So I think it's the most significant gainer in last hour of trade today. Sobha, another stock that Neeraj has been tracking. If you look at it, it's ending the day with gains of almost 12%. Yet another excellent day for this stock. Shemaru has come back after correcting last week a bit. Stock went up today by around 10.5%. That's the level we see right now. HOEC was another key gainer, and it has benefited by the numbers. With its peak to the management, stock is ending the day with gains of almost 9%. Jubilant Food is yet another key gainer on the back of strong quarterly numbers. That stock is also up by almost 8.5%, closing above 2250 quite comfortably. Chemical stocks were also doing well. So Make Money Organic would be a significant gainer from this space. What has not done well today is Gruha Finance. All the numbers were good, but valuation concerned, and stock is off 15% or so, going to end the day very, very close to the day's lowest level. Sugar is also not doing well. In global commodity prices over the last 2 weeks or so, sugar prices have corrected quite a bit from $15.5 per ounce to it's now down to almost 13.5. And that is also reflecting in stock prices. In fact, the outlook also remains bullish for sugar output, which means prices may decline further. And probably that's why all these stocks are under pressure today, Neeraj.
Yeah, you were marking this in the morning as well, I remember. And the stocks continue to fall in today's trade in the afternoon too. So this is the picture at close. I want to bring up the BSE mid-cap or the NSE mid-cap, BSE mid-cap, BSE small-cap indices too, just once, and just show you what's happened at the broader end of the spectrum too. The Nifty Bank is up 0.5%, so that's okay. But the mid-caps and the small-caps today have actually participated. This is unlike what happened in a larger duration of last week, where in 2 or 3 days, we had the large caps participating and mid caps cracking. Today's been a rather good day for the mid caps as well. And if you bring up one, the volumes and then the contributors list, you will see a distinct move towards the heavyweights which have participated and a decent volume day as well. 35,000-36,000 odd crores, so at par with what we've been doing. We had an odd 41,000 crore day as well once last week, but that was maybe an aberration. By and large, the going is good. And look at the contributors list, you will see two heavyweights, Reliance and TCS, really accounting for the bulk of the heavy lifting that they have done. The two largest caps in India have participated today, and on a day like that, you can't really have the markets not doing well. So really good going. HDFC has come off. ICICI Bank ever so marginally down in trade. SBI down marginally in trade. Financials probably not the best of days. Haven't really cracked. Keep in mind, Nifty Bank is still about 0.5% higher. So by and large, financials too have contributed. Just that one or two of these heavyweights haven't really done quite well. And the others, like Axis Bank post results, up about 9% in the session. So even Stevens, you would say in terms of the green versus the red, but just that heavyweights like TCS and Reliance participating and pulling in the index higher. ONGC, by the way, I shouldn't forget, up about 3.5% too, and Larsen & Toubro up about a couple of percentage points. So IT, Reliance, certain stocks like L&T and ONGC participating. Pretty decent day of trade, you would have to admit, in the session. Final thoughts from our experts. Jay, what about a call on ONGC? You were very bullish on Reliance. What about ONGC?
Well, see, ONGC, you know, was trading in this kind of a range, I would say, and was not able to surpass the levels of 200. Maybe it was, you know, there was always thought that, you know, what could be a deal of ONGC and HPCL be like? And now, since we know that this is definitely in favor of ONGC, mostly I would say it is more inclined towards ONGC. Definitely, we have seen that kind of a move coming in today's trading session. But along with that, I would say one more thing that, you know, this stock has been, you know, finding resistance around 210, 212 levels. So it needs to really take off those levels of 212, close above those levels for at least a day or two in order to confirm the up move. Even if it takes off intraday, I would say initially to trigger a good buy on the upside. About 212, definitely what would happen, Neeraj, is that, you know, the next move on the upside would be confirmed, and that's an impulse move. Any which ways, you know, it is going to come on the upside, and we would see the levels of 275, 280 in a medium to long term. Definitely medium term, we would see these levels coming in ONGC, at least say in a quarter or so. But if someone is really looking out for a momentum, that, you know, someone has bought it and, you know, can book it out in say a week's time or so, I think 212 is the level to watch out for. If those levels get taken off, then as 240, 245 will be the immediate target.
Well, let's just pull up Vakrangi Limited, an important update highlighted by Darshan, that the market cap of this company has crossed 50,000 crore in today's session. And well, not to forget, Darshan had covered this stock in November sometime when the market cap was only about 37,000 crore. And he also highlighted how this penny stock has given you multi-bagger returns in the last few years. In fact, from 16 rupees a piece in 2010, to the current level of almost 474. Himain, your closing thoughts and also a thought on Vakrangi.
I think everything is fine. Maybe it's a bit overheated, but then I think it's a run-up to the budget. So everything seems fine, a bit too fine the way I see it. The week, the open interest, budget, expiry. I'd say one needs to be light or cautious on leverage positions. In terms of Vakrangi, all-time highs now, frankly speaking, not much to go on. A small consolidation, we've broken out from there. Further upside possible, but it's been a perpendicular rise. I'm not sure if any technical theories apply to something like this.
Okay, Himain, as well as Jay, appreciate both of you joining us today and taking us through your technical take on the markets. Well, it's time for us to slip into a quick break. We'll be back with more on the other side.
हमारे पड़ोसी मेहताज हॉलिडे के लिए अब्रॉड गए हैं। हम कब जाएंगे?
उसके लिए पैसे कहाँ से आएंगे?
लेकिन मिट्ठू,
इन्वेस्ट इन्वेस्ट,
और उस पर इन शुक्ला जी की जिम्मेदारी छोड़ गए हमारे सर।
FDs में इन्वेस्ट करूँ क्या?
अरे मिट्ठू जी, आज के जमाने में इन्फ्लेशन के बाद FD रिटर्न से हाथ में क्या बचता है? ETF में इन्वेस्ट कीजिए, जिससे लॉन्ग टर्म में मिलते हैं स्टॉक मार्केट जैसे हायर रिटर्न्स, यानी इन्फ्लेशन का कम असर।
लेकिन स्टॉक मार्केट तो ऊपर नीचे होता ही रहता है।
ETF लॉन्ग टर्म इन्वेस्टमेंट के लिए बिल्कुल उपयुक्त है। ये देखिए, हायर रिटर्न्स, इन्फ्लेशन बीटर एंड नो टैक्सेस। ETF में निवेश कीजिए और देखिए हाथ में कितना बचता है। भाभी जी, जरा कोकोनट ऑयल देना।
ETF investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.
White shirts. कितने plain और simple. Fox scent. Plain और simple white shirt को बना दे special और fashionable. Fox scent. New fashion wear for men.
What do we want from our country today? From the economy, from the politicians, the policy makers.
Do we want a better deal?
Maybe more perks for smaller businesses or large businesses or any businesses.
Do we want it to be easier to create something new?
To find the job of our dreams. To create jobs for dreamers.
Do we want growth?
not just for the sake of growth, but for what it represents.
Not just numbers on a graph somewhere, but prosperity that we can see, touch, feel.
These things we want.
Can we expect them? Realistically.
It's time. Time for us to accept less and expect more.
Time for us to get on the path to confidence once again.
Time to go from making promises
to keeping them.
From manufacturing slogans
to really making it in India.
From a promising economy
to a delivering economy.
Can this budget mark a return to confidence?
Watch Budget 2018 with Bloomberg Quint.
Welcome back. You're still watching Countdown with us on Bloomberg Quint. Well, Sridhar Shivaram of Enam Holdings is bullish on corporate-oriented banks, and he says opportunities can be found in both private as well as public sector banks, despite the gap in valuations between these two sectors. Here's a slice of that conversation he had with us earlier in the day.
We are very bullish on the corporate-facing banks. And that's a change in stance over the last 6-9 months. We've done a lot of work on the entire IBC process. We've met people who are in the government, who are in the process of bidding, the people who are running some of these companies currently, the IBC professionals. And the sense we've got is that the bidding process may surprise the market. Keep in mind the banks have already provided 50% of the loans as provisions. Our understanding, or at least our calculation, shows that the banks may not need 50%, at least for the larger ones. Mm-hmm. And we've already seen numbers for Binani, where 4,000 crore, already there's bid for 6,000 crore. We think the large steel ones will also surprise the market. Keep in mind that 6-9 months back to today, the cycle has turned.
Yes.
So we know that some of the large guys have come and done a due diligence process on some of these steel companies. A lot of the details are there in the public media, so I don't need to spell out those. We think that this will surprise the market. So what happens from here is that a lot of these, so the first 12-13 cases are 25% of the NPA. These are non-interest bearing today because they are non-performing. Once these gets resolved, whatever is the balance of the loan on which the bidding is happening will become a performing loan. This will move out of the NPA. So it'll have multiple impact. Not only does your balance sheet start looking better, your income generating assets starts to improve. So your income will start looking better. And I think the most important thing is most of these banks are currently engaged in the negative energy thing, which is trying to solve a problem.
Mm-hmm.
You're not looking at the business.
Business.
Once this starts to resolve itself, you will start looking at new business. Keep in mind that there's also a capital process which is started by the government. So when I put all these things together, we think there's a huge opportunity there on the corporate facing banks. So it could be on the private sector, it could be on the public sector. People can take their pick and choose a choice from some of these. We think there's an opportunity here. I'm not saying this is like a secular opportunity, but over the next 2 years, this will surely surprise the market. So
what part of your portfolio is this in? Is this a tactical
20% safe return portfolio category play, or are you even looking for much higher returns from some of these undervalued names, and therefore they may not necessarily be the large ones? Just trying to get a gauge here. No, given our size, most of it is the large ones. Large ones. But these are not going to be 20% returns. If that be the case, I need not be here. Sure. If it plays out, if the thesis plays out, and from whatever we can see, very high probability that this does play out the way we are envisaging, then the returns could be fairly significant. But there's nothing guaranteed in the market.
Of course.
So these are work that we do based on certain assumptions, certain thesis, and we'll have to see how it plays out. We think that there is a huge opportunity, especially in the financial space, especially in the corporate facing banks in particular, including PSUs.
Okay. What about the non-banking side? Where are you bullish? Where are you bearish?
Yeah. So non-banking space, NBFCs in general, we are not so bullish. When I'm saying we're not bullish, doesn't mean that it's an embargo, it's a complete no-no for everything in a broad space, because there are two, three events that have happened. One is that interest rate itself is going up. We've seen at least 100 basis points increase in the interest rate. This does have an impact on NBFCs in general, because their cost of liability does tend to go up. The second event, of course, is that once this entire IBC process gets resolved, the large part of the PSU banks will come back into the market today, which has been vacated. So there'll be some competition. I agree that some of these NBFCs are in niche areas, so they may still continue to do well. And three is that the valuation, some of these NBFCs are already quite stretched. So the risk reward from this point of time looks slightly stretched.
It's a muted start to trade for the European indices. Let's head across to Sandra Kiloff, who brings us up to speed with how the action is so far. Sandra, good morning to you. How is it looking like?
Good morning. Well, as you said, European equities having a bit of a mixed start to the trading day. We're seeing the Stoxx 600 benchmark relatively flat at the moment, the FTSE 100 barely in the green, while the DAX and CAC 40 both are down 0.1%. So a very mixed bag here in Europe. Markets really digesting a slew of M&A announcements this morning. One stock to watch is Sanofi, which has dropped more than 2% in Paris after agreeing to buy BioVeritiv for about $11.6 billion in a bid by France's biggest drug maker to add treatments for rare blood disorders to its portfolio. Now, the deal values hemophilia drug maker BioVeritiv at $105 a share. That's a 64% premium over Friday's closing price. Meanwhile, UK grocery delivery group Ocado has jumped more than 10% in London trading. That's after it unveiled a deal with Canadian supermarket group Sobeys. The pact in which Ocado will team up with Sobeys to build a robotic warehouse is seen as a key step in the group's transformation into a technology provider for the retail industry. Meanwhile, in currencies, the euro has climbed 0.2% to 1.2251 against the dollar, while the British pound has increased 0.3% to 1.3905. That's the strongest level in 19 months. And finally, in fixed income, the yield on German 10-year bonds has advanced 1 basis point to 0.58%. That's the highest in a week. It comes amid optimism over German Chancellor Angela Merkel's potential breakthrough for a fourth term in office. Back to you.
Thanks for that. Well, moving on, with days left for the Union Budget 2018, the bond markets, they seem worried about the government being unable to meet its fiscal deficit target for the current year and questions on what happens to the target for the next year. Bloomberg Quint's Ira Dugal sat down with Pranjal Bhandari of HSBC to get a broader perspective on this. Here is a slice of that conversation. Listen in.
You know, I think it's a very delicate year, and any kind of fiscal adventurism during this period might not be very palatable. It's a very strange year. Last 2-3 years, we've benefited a lot from oil prices coming down. They're rising now, $65 to $75, in the wink of an eye. It's really reversing a lot of the macro gains. Inflation is going up, the twin deficits are widening. The FX reserves, you don't know where they will be with the current account deficit widening as well. So it's a year in which policymakers should be a little careful, because because now if you run a higher deficit than you've promised in the past, it will not be taken well by the outside world, by macro stability watchers and so on. So it's a year to be conservative rather than profligate.
Taken that point, but in this case, I guess the slippage would come not because they're spending too much or exceeding their spending targets, but because there is volatility in revenues due to GST. And I think world over, there would have been some volatility on the implementation of GST. Still not willing to...
Well, look, I think, sort of looking at what you're seeing from the other side, now is the time to focus really uniformly on GST to make sure that all the benefits of GSTs, are actually gained as early as possible. You know, a couple of things that the government can do is to, not tinker with rates again, bring some certainty, become faster with refunds, with rebates, and so on. Try to curb tax evasion with all the e-way bill and so on. I think if the government focuses on that, it will give them enough extra revenue to actually meet some of the expenses like in rural distress and so on, and without getting a higher fiscal deficit. So really the right place to focus on is to get the GST to work quickly and efficiently and not focus on, again, skipping the fiscal deficit target.
Not taking the easy route out. Because also the issue is if you go to say 3.4, 3.5 this year, then how do you, where do you go next year? Probably tough to go to 3 next year then, right?
I think it's tough, but since you ask, I would say that if this year the government inches at 3.4 or below and next year 3.2 or below, I think, the market will be able to digest that. But I worry that anything more than that, it will become very difficult for the markets, especially because it's not just the central government borrowing, it's also the state government borrowings on top of that. Yeah. Which, brings me to the other point, which is that after a very long time next year, the states will have an opportunity to become much more fiscally disciplined. The 7th Pay Commission is going to be sort of behind them in terms of incremental expenses. Their program is, mostly done and so on. Oil prices are rising a little bit, which incidentally benefits the states. So for the first time, some few things are going in the state's favor. It's a good time for the center to actually be disciplined so that the state can actually follow the center's example and also try to consolidate a little bit. I think there are many benefits from the center trying to be as disciplined as it can this year.
And the flip side of it is that they can't afford these higher borrowing costs, not just for them, but for what it does to corporate borrowing costs and then taking away the benefits of whatever upside we've seen in growth.
Yes, that's correct. As in, it's very clear from anybody who watches the data, who's looked at this data in the last 10 to 20 years, that high 10-year bond yields, as we're seeing them today, lead to high corporate bond yields and really squeeze that section out. Also, the government is really trying to help the small-scale industries. But remember, the small-scale industries, small enterprises, they don't have access to capital markets, they don't have access to foreign flows. The formal part of them completely relies on banking sector. If the government deceives by running higher fiscal deficit, it just squeezes out the revenue pot, which is available for MSMEs and small businesses. So really, I don't see too much benefit from the government actually running a high fiscal deficit on any front.
Sure. Tell me something. So, I mean, if you assume that they want to stick to their fiscal target this year, could this hurt growth a little bit? Or do you think that we're not in a scenario where they would cut capital expenditure and hence hurt growth? They'll manage through, say, non-tax revenues, etc., you feel?
Well, I do believe that if they can get the GST right and see some tax buoyancy on the back of GST over the next year, which is FY19, they might be able to get extra funds to fund, some of the requirements in rural distress and so on. So in that sense, be supportive of growth and yet stick to some of the fiscal targets and preserve macro stability. I think it's possible. There's just one, there's just one piece of the puzzle that has to fit, which is GST. You really have to get the revenues flowing quickly.
All right, moving on, the Road Transport and Highways Minister Nitin Gadkari is confident of infrastructure getting top priority in this year's budget spends. Well, in an exclusive conversation on our special series, Rajpad, Gadkari said that the budgetary allocation will be used for purposes like land acquisition. Listen in to this exclusive conversation.
Jitna paisa aapko chahiye in sare kaamon ko karne ke liye, usme budget ki ek limitation hai. Lekin chunki abhi budget aane wala hai, to zahir hai ki sab logon ki baat isi nazar isi baat par hai कि जॉब क्रिएटिंग काम जो है वो इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर वाले मंत्रालयों से हो सकता है, जल्दी हो सकता है, ऑलरेडी हम बहुत लेट हैं। इस बार का बजट आप लोगों को इंक्रीमेंटली थोड़ा बहुत पैसा बढ़ के मिलेगा या कोई बहुत बड़ा कोई नया बदलाव आने जा रहा है?
देखिए, फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर हर समय इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर डेवलपमेंट को प्रायोरिटी देते हैं और वो इस बात को अच्छी तरह से समझते हैं कि देश के विकास में रोजगार निर्माण करने के लिए इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर बहुत ज़रूरी है और इसलिए नए बस पोर्ट बनाना, अभी नए एक्सप्रेस हाईवे बनाना, उसके लिए लैंड एक्विजिशन करना पड़ रहा है। हम लोग अभी बद्रीनाथ, केदारनाथ, गंगोत्री, यमुनोत्री का रोड बना रहे हैं नया, उधर मानस सरोवर का रोड बना रहे हैं, एक्सप्रेस हाईवे बना रहे हैं, करीब 1000 से ज़्यादा नए आर यू बी बना रहे हैं। तो मुझे लगता है कि निश्चित रूप से हमारे फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर निश्चित रूप से इसमें ध्यान रखेंगे और ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा प्रोविजन हमको देंगे, ये मेरा विश्वास है। और दूसरा, उसके साथ साथ मैं गंगा रिजर्वेशन में तो उनने पैसा दिया है, हम खर्चा नहीं कर पाए क्योंकि हमारे काम शुरू नहीं हुए थे, पर उसके साथ साथ जो रिवर कनेक्टिविटी है, नदी जोड़ प्रकल्प, उस प्रकल्प में से 5 बड़े प्रोजेक्ट हम शुरू करना चाहते हैं, वो भी प्रोजेक्ट करीब 1.5 लाख करोड़ के हैं। तो मैं चाहूँगा कि उसके लिए कुछ प्रोविज़न करके हमको फॉरेन लोन लेने की भी अनुमति वो देते हैं। तो इसके कारण देश में जो प्रधानमंत्री जी का सपना है कि 2022 तक हम देश में किसानों की आमदनी दुगनी करें, दुगनी उसी समय हो सकती है जब इरीगेशन हो सकता है, तो 1,88,00,000 हेक्टेयर ज़मीन पानी के नीचे आएगी। तो मुझे लगता है कि इस काम के लिए भी फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर जरूर रूरल और एग्रीकल्चर डेवलपमेंट के लिए सोचेंगे, ये मेरा विश्वास है।
सर, आपने फॉरेन लोन की बात की, सस्ते लोन की बात कही है पहले भी, मेरा यही तो सवाल है आपसे कि उसकी ज़रूरत क्या है? सरकार की, जनता की संपदा का एसेट मोनिटाइजेशन बिना अपना स्वामित्व खोए ज़्यादा बड़ी रकम उठाने का और खुद मुख्तारी के साथ अपना काम करने का जब मौका है, तो ये चूंकि बहुत रेडिकल लगता है, तो क्या मैं ये मानूं कि सरकार का कोई बहुत बड़ा काम एसेट मोनेटाइजेशन की तरफ करने का है?
ये ऑलरेडी सरकार अपने अनेक पब्लिक एंटरप्राइजेस है जिसके लिए मैं और अरुण जेटली जी की कमेटी है, लॉस मेकिंग पब्लिक अंडरटेकिंग है, बड़े प्रमाण पर उसको डिसइन्वेस्ट कर रहे हैं।
लेकिन उससे दूसरी बात नहीं है कि ड्रेजिंग कॉरपोरेशन का डिसइन्वेस्टमेंट हो?
100% होगा, कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है। उसके साथ साथ अभी हम लोग हमारे NHAI के जो प्रोजेक्ट बनाए 105, उसको मोनिटाइज करके 1,25,00,000 करोड़ हम मिला रहे हैं। तो सवाल इस बात का नहीं है, हम करेंगे ही, पर उसके साथ साथ जैसे लैंड एक्विजिशन है, उन बातों के लिए ऐसे एसेट यूज़ करने के बजाय हम लोग लैंड एक्विजिशन के लिए हमको बजट की आवश्यकता है। तो मुझे लगता है कि बुनियादी आवश्यकताओं के लिए बजट का सपोर्ट करेंगे और बाकी जैसे हम पोर्ट बनाते हैं तो ब्रेक वाटर और लैंड एक्विजिशन हम करते हैं और बाकी पूरा हमारा लैंडलॉर्ड बेस ये पोर्ट बनता है, तो बाकी सब BOT में और PPP में देते हैं।
आपने हम जैसों की कमाई के लिए एश्योर्ड रिटर्न वाला NHAI वगैरह का बॉन्ड लाने की भी बात कही, हम तो उसका इंतजार कर रहे हैं।
देखिए, वो भी लाएंगे क्योंकि अभी मेरे पास पैसा सरप्लस है, अगर आज मैं ले लूँगा तो मुझे बैंक में रखना पड़ेगा।
अच्छा।
तो मैं निश्चित रूप से मार्च अप्रैल में हम लोग आएंगे, क्योंकि तब तक हमारा पैसा भी सब खर्चा कर
मार्च अप्रैल में NHAI का?
हाँ, पक्का आएंगे। और मैंने तय किया है कि अब रोड निर्माण करने के लिए पत्रकार हो, डॉक्टर हो, प्रोफेसर हो, वकील हो, कर्मचारी हो, कांस्टेबल हो, मिलिट्री डिफेंस में काम करने वाले हमारे सैनिक रिटायर्ड हो, वो हो, 60 साल के रिटायर्ड वाले लोग हो जिनको बैंक में 6% से भी कम इंटरेस्ट मिल रहा, उनको 8% इंटरेस्ट देने की मैं कोशिश करूँगा और 10 साल के लिए उनको गारंटी दूँगा, तो उनका फ़ायदा होगा।
Well, you can catch that entire conversation today at 10 p.m. on Bloomberg Quint.
With that, it's a wrap on this leg of Countdown from Nitin and me. Thanks so much for watching.